Hachette Audio presents The Scorpion's Tale, written by Douglas Preston and Lincoln Child, read by Cynthia Farrell. In memory of William Smithback Jr., in pace requiescat. Chapter 1. Since graduating from the academy 8 months before, Special Agent Corrie Swanson had learned to expect almost anything. Nevertheless, she hadn't expected to be serving warrants on bawling teenagers. As she rode back through the mountains with the rest of the FBI team, she felt relieved that a difficult day was almost over. They were returning from the town of Edgewood, having served the warrant on a pimply-faced hacker who, when he answered the door of his mother's house, had broken down in tears at the sight of them. Corrie felt bad for the kid, and then felt bad for feeling bad, because, after all, he'd hacked into a classified network at Los Alamos National Laboratory just for fun. Now his computers, external hard drives, iPhone, USB sticks, PlayStation, and even home security system were all loaded into the black Navigator with tinted windows that was following their vehicle with Agent Liz Corrie at the wheel and Agent Harry Martinez riding shotgun. Corrie sat next to her boss, Supervisory Special Agent Hale Morwood, who was driving the least likely G-Ride Corrie had ever seen. A late model Nissan pickup, loaded, in candy apple red with racing stripes, and a Chinese dragon decal running diagonally across the hood. It was totally unlike Morwood's dry personality. When Corrie had finally screwed up the courage to ask her boss why he drove it, his response had been,
"I travel incognito." "So," Morwood said, shifting into his mentoring voice, "enough excitement for you today?"
Difficult or not, Corrie knew that the day had been a reward of sorts. She'd put in more than her share of desk duty, worked hard to impress Morwood, and even managed to play a major role in a recent case. To Morwood, no doubt this was the equivalent of a field trip. Still, she knew he wouldn't like a display of gratitude. "I felt a little silly," she said, "wearing a bulletproof vest on a call like that."
"You never know. Instead of just yelling, that mother might have pulled out a 357 Magnum.
What are they going to do with all that computer equipment?"
"The lab will look at it, find out exactly what he did and how, and then we'll go back and arrest him. And his life will be over."
Corrie swallowed.
"Seems harsh to you?"
"He didn't fit my idea of a criminal, to be honest."
"Me neither. Smart kid, stable middle-class home, straight-A student, promising future. That, in a way, makes it worse than, say, some kid who grows up in the inner city and starts dealing drugs because it's all he knows. Our boy is 18, he's an adult, and he broke into a system that holds classified nuclear bomb information."
"I get it, totally." After a moment, Morwood said,
"It's good to have compassion. That's something a lot of agents lose over time. But balance it with a sense of justice. He's going to get a fair trial in front of 12 ordinary, common-sense Americans. That's how it works, and it's a beautiful system."
Corrie nodded. Morwood was a 20-year agent, and his lack of cynicism continually surprised her. Maybe that's why he'd been tapped to mentor new agents during their 2-year probationary period. So many of her fellow rookies, most of the guys, even some of the women, were already trying on a tough, cynical, hard-boiled macho persona. They were passing through the town of Tijeras, on old Route 66, when Morwood reached down and turned up the volume on the police scanner, which had been murmuring in the background.
"Domestic, Cedro Peak Campground, report of shots fired."
Corrie brought her wandering thoughts to attention.
Reports indicate a domestic dispute and shots fired in a camper. Possible shooting victim, possible hostage situation. Location, Cedro Peak Campground, New Mexico 252, Sabino Canyon turnoff. Well, I'll be damned, said Morwood, fiddling with his navigation program. That's just around the corner. Looks like this is one for us. He pulled down his mic. Special Agents Morwood and Swanson, Corrie and Martinez responding. We're passing through to Harris on Route 66, turning onto New Mexico 337 South. 10 minutes out. Morwood accelerated, talking to the dispatcher and the agents in the following car. The tires squealed as he took the turn from Route 66 onto 337, heading into the foothills of the Sandia Mountains. As he did so, he reached for the dash, hitting the siren and activating the hideaway lights. The SUV followed suit. The dispatcher relayed all the information she had, which was precious little. Essentially, others in the campground had called 911, reporting an incident in a pop-up camper. A loud argument. A woman screaming. Shots fired. One said he thought he heard a little girl crying as well. Naturally, everyone in the campground had gotten the hell out. Looks like we're going to get some real action, not just a crybaby hacker, Morwood said. We're the first responders. Check your weapon. Corrie felt her heart accelerate. She removed her Glock 19M from the underarm holster, popped out the magazine, checked it, then reinserted and reholstered. Per standard procedure, there was already a round in the chamber. She was glad to still be wearing the bulletproof vest. Domestics, said Morwood, switching again into mentoring mode. As you probably learned at the academy, can be the most dangerous of calls. The perp can be irrational, agitated, and often suicidal.
Right. The speedometer edged up to 70 miles an hour, which, while not fast in itself, was frightening enough on a mountain road with steep drop-offs and few guardrails. The tires gave a little protest of rubber at each curve. So, what's the plan of action? Corrie asked. This wasn't some pimply kid. This was real. This was her first active shooter call.
They've called in a SWAT team and a CNU negotiator, and the FBI has got the CERG on alert. So what we do is, we take up defensive positions, announce, assess, and de-escalate. Basically, we keep the guy talking until the pros arrive.
What if he's taken a hostage?
In that case, the key is to keep him talking, reassure him, and focus on getting him to release the hostage. Unless it's a crisis, the less we do, the better. The most dangerous moment is when we first arrive and the shooter sees us. So we go in nice and easy. No shouting. No confrontational stuff. Should be a cakewalk. Good experience for you.
He paused.
But if things go south, just follow my instructions.
Got it.
Remind me of your shooting qualification score.
49.
Corrie reddened.
That was barely above qualification, and followed weeks of practice at the range so intense, her forearms had ached for days. Shooting just wasn't her forte. Morwood grunted a non-reply and pressed still harder on the accelerator. The truck flying up the meandering two-lane road that climbed through pinyon and juniper-clad hillsides. 5 minutes brought them to the turnoff for the Cedro Peak Group Campground in Cibola National Forest, and another 5 to a gravel road. Morwood eased back on his speed. In a few more minutes, they arrived at the campground. A peaceful, grassy basin with picnic tables, a group shelter, and fire pits set among pinyon trees, with the great mass of Sandia Crest rising behind. At the far end of a loop road, she could see a lone camper attached to a white Ford pickup. The rest of the campground was empty of people, with a few tents scattered around. Morwood turned his truck into the right side of the loop and gestured out the window for Corrie and Martinez to go around the other way and converge at the far end.
"Keep down in case he shoots at us," said Morwood. "I'm going to drive in as close as I can."
He pulled the truck to within 20 feet of the camper. No shots were fired. The camper was one of the kind that fold open, with sleeping compartments on either side of a central living space, screened in with mosquito netting and white nylon.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.